At this time, if I could have everyone please rise as we honor America's colors, and please remain standing for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please remain standing.
Order, arm, mark time, mark, right turn, mark.
Please be seated. This morning we have a great opportunity to learn about our flag under the direction of Commander David Walls and Chapter 840 of the Military Order of the Purple Heart. Let's please give him a round of applause as we welcome him.
There's a holiday coming up Monday. Does anybody know what holiday it is? Quite a few hands. Not nearly as many as there should be. It's Memorial Day. Memorial Day is a time when we remember those who died in service to the country. And that's what its purpose is. It's not about veterans. It's about remembering those who gave their lives. First, I want to tell you a little bit about our organization. I'm with the Military Order of the Purple Heart, and you probably never heard of that. Does anybody, can I see hands? Anybody know what a Purple Heart is? Well, quite a few of you do. That's an award that's given by our government for those who are wounded in battle at the hands of the enemy. And with me today, I have three other members of our chapter. First gentleman in the ball cap from the 82nd Airborne is Don Jakewell. The one in the middle is David Vandergriff. He's our adjutant for our chapter. And the gentleman on the far end is Bob Bolton. He's the junior vice commander for our chapter, Military Order of Purple Heart. We haven't been around Lincoln County very long, only since 2011. But our national organization has been in existence since 1932. Like most veterans organizations, we try to gain membership. But ours is very small. We only have 55 members in our chapter. And the reason is, to be a member of the Military Order of the Purple Heart, you have to have been issued a Purple Heart. And it has to be recorded. We vet people to make sure that everyone who applies for membership was wounded in battle. We're a veteran service organization. We try to promote camaraderie among combat veterans. And we try to help other veterans with any service needs they may have. That's enough about our chapter. I want to tell you a little bit about Memorial Day. Memorial Day was actually a holiday, which originally was called Decoration Day. And it started spontaneously around the country at different sites where people would go and decorate the graves of their loved ones who were killed in battle. It wasn't made a actual holiday as Memorial Day till 1967. So that's quite a few years that went by from the Civil War. That's over 100 years before it was actually made a holiday. It used to be on May 30th. The reason they took May 30th, because that was a good day that most of the flowers were in full bloom, and it was convenient to decorate graves. But in 1960, I think it was 67, yeah, there was a uniform, let's see what it was called, Uniform Holiday Act enacted by Congress, which moved a lot of holidays to a Monday. I guess so federal workers would get a three-day weekend. Anyway, General John Logan in 1868 was the first one to call for a national observance of Memorial Day. So it's very dear to us veterans who survived war. We lost a lot of friends. You try not to make friends in the military, but you can't avoid it. It happens. And you lose them friends. So remember that Memorial Day is a day that we remember those who gave their life for this country. Okay, right now, is Jason here? We're going to show you a video which pretty well tells the story of what Memorial Day is. Seen in movies where the flag is folded. The flag is placed over the casket of the deceased veteran. At this time, we're going to do a flag folding, and there's symbolism and meaning in each fold. You've probably never heard it, most people haven't, but I will read the significance of each fold as they fold the flag. The first fold is a symbol of life. The second fold is a symbol of our belief in an eternal life. The third fold is made in honor and remembrance of the veteran departing our ranks who gave a portion of his life for the defense of our country to attain a peace throughout the world. The fourth fold represents our weaker nature, for as American citizens trusting in God, it is to Him we turn to in times of peace, as well in times of war, for divine guidance. The fifth fold is a tribute to our country, for in the words of Stephen Decatur, our country in dealing with other countries, may she always be right, but it is still our country, right or wrong. The sixth fold is for where our hearts lie. It is with our heart that we pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. The seventh fold is a tribute to the armed forces, for it is through the armed forces that we protect our country and our flag against all her enemies, whether they be found within or without the borders of our republic. The eighth fold is a tribute to the one who entered into the valley of the shadow of death, that we might see the light of day, and to honor Mother, for whom it flies on Mother's Day. The ninth fold is a tribute to womanhood, for it has been through their faith, love, loyalty, and devotion that the character of the men and women who have made this country great have been molded. The tenth fold is a tribute to Father, for He too has given His sons and daughters for the defense of our country since they were first born. The 11th fold in the eyes of a Hebrew citizen represents the lower portion of the seal of King David and King Solomon and glorifies in their eyes the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. The 12th fold in the eyes of a Christian citizen represents an emblem of eternity and glorifies in their eyes God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Fallout. When the flag is folded at the funeral, there's usually a next of kin there, a widow, a mother, father, someone to accept the flag. The flag is presented and the casualty officer or the sergeant in charge of the burial detail makes this statement, "Dear madam or sir," whichever the case may be, "this flag is presented on behalf of a grateful nation as an expression of appreciation for the honorable and faithful service rendered by your loved one." Now, we're going to show a video. It's a little dated, a number of years ago, but I think it applies to you people.
He says, "I have been listening to you boys and girls recite the Pledge of Allegiance all semester, and it seems as though it's becoming monotonous to you. If I may I recite it and try to explain to you the meaning of each word. I, me, an individual, a committee of one, pledge, dedicate all of my worldly goods to give without self-pity. Allegiance, my love and my devotion to the flag, our standard, O glory, a symbol of freedom. Wherever she waves, there's respect, because your loyalty has given her a dignity that shouts freedom is everybody's job. United, that means that we have all come together. States, individual communities that have united into 48 great states, 48 individual communities with pride, dignity, and purpose, all divided with imaginary boundaries, yet united to a common purpose, and that's love for country. And to the Republic, a state in which sovereign power is invested in representatives chosen by the people to govern. And government is the people, and it's from the people to the leaders, not from the leaders to the people, for which it stands. One nation, me, so blessed by God, indivisible, incapable of being divided, with liberty, which is freedom, the right of power to live one's own life without threats, fear, or some sort of retaliation, and justice, the principle or qualities of dealing fairly with others. For all, which means, boys and girls, it's as much your country as it is mine. And now, boys and girls, let me hear you recite the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Since I was a small boy, two states have been added to our country, and two words have been added to the Pledge of Allegiance, under God. Wouldn't it be a pity if someone said that is a prayer and that could be eliminated from schools too?
Like the video said, that this country is as much your country as it is mine. And I hope you take care of it. Now, I want to introduce a friend of mine, author, two books, The 508th Regiment, is that one of them, Don? The 508th, and Paratroopers Do or Die. And Don's going to share his experiences. And he's a veteran, 82nd Airborne, All-Americans. He jumped in Normandy in World War II. So welcome, Don Jakeway.
On my way down, as I usually do, I keep saying, what a man, 91 years old, come down and talk to a bunch of young people like you to keep me interested in something that happened in my life 70 years ago. So I'll keep it kind of brief, just give an idea of what happened. In 1942, I graduated from Youngstown. I enlisted in the Airborne Services. At that time, it was very unique because airborne forces had not been formed yet. So I was one of the first of the recruits to be enlisted. We had to enlist, couldn't be very yet in good physical condition and so forth, to get into the Airborne Services. So the 82nd Airborne is the granddaddy of all airborne in the United States. Our 82nd Airborne fought in North Africa, Sicily, and Italy, Normandy, Holland, the Battle of the Bulge, and into Germany. Now, my experiences were a little different than most military because our training was absolutely, it was beyond rude for us, being an old farm kid going into this stuff. So what I'm going to do is, in 1942, when we went into the service, it took 2,400 recruits to make 130 paratroopers. Now, when I told my parents that I was going to enlist in the airborne to jump out of airplanes, I was 18 years old. I had a little difficulty of them agreeing for me to do that when they hadn't done it anyway. But before I get started on this, I got to tell you, I played football, I was in physical condition, I was a good athlete and in school. And when I went over to recruit, to sign up, I had a 29 Chevrolet Cavalier with a roll seat and so forth, and very popular in the school as a senior. And I had one visor, U.S. Marines, U.S. Navy. When I went to the Marine Corps, I passed all my physical except one thing, and you can believe me, I had one too many teeth pulled. I went to the Navy, told me the same thing. It was unheard of because back in those days you had to be almost perfect to get into these services. But when I enlisted in the Airborne, passed the physical, everything was okay, I asked them what happened. Told him about my situation with the teeth, and he says, "Can you eat steak?" And I said, "Well, sure." And believe it or not, ladies and gentlemen, I still have them. I still have my teeth. So I don't guess I'll have to fight my way through the war by biting people or whatever. Anyhow, in our training, I trained at Camp Cocoa, Georgia, Fort Camp Landing, Florida, Fort Benning, Georgia, Camp Ball, North Carolina. And I know this may sound a little boring to you guys, but for an 18-year-old, it was very exciting. I can remember going through the Okefenokee swamps in our training, the Chattahoochee River areas, alligators, snakes, and all the training we went through. I was a demolition expert. I worked with high explosive and stuff like that, so I learned a lot from my basic training. I got one furlough home during my 3 years in the service, 7 days. When I came back to Camp Apollo, North Carolina, we were told that we were going to be getting ready for combat. So on maneuvers one day, I'm going to do something that I don't normally do. My wife said, "Don't do this. You're going to make these people leave the room." I said, "Well," it was raining one night, and I wrote two paragraphs to a song. And it took me all night to do this. Thinking we were going into the Pacific, the song goes like this, and I'm just going to try to give you an idea of what we were thinking about. It goes like this. Far across the Pacific to the island of Japan, we got a score to settle down, and the time is now at hand. We're going to send the bear troops to sail across the sea to make this country safe for those who love democracy. Hear the airplane motors humming, hear the angry bullets flying.
We're going to send Purdue to slaughter all the swine. No, the days are not good when a Purdue's round and fall. We'll send this message to them with the troopers from McCall. Took me all night to write that. Some of the highlights of some of the good times, maybe, that we had. But when we went to New York at Camp Shanks, we were told we were going to Europe. And on December the 23rd, 1943, we boarded the USS James Parker, took off across the ocean. During that time, the Wolf Pack, which was a German submarine, were sinking many, many, many of our ships. In fact, off of the coast of Florida, 3.5 miles out, German submarines were sinking our ships. So we knew that in this convoy that we were in danger, because there was 4,000 paratroopers just on this one ship we were on. The convoy had about 100 vessels in it. It took us 11 days to get across. 3 of our ships were sunk. We sent about the same number of the submarines. We landed in Belfast, Ireland. Met the Port Stewart and began our training there for our advanced training into combat. But because of the hours of the daylight and the dark, we moved down to Nottingham, England, in the middle of Sherwood Forest, to finish up our training. When we got ready to go, they took us out to a camp at Folkingham Airport, locked us in this area of business in for 2 weeks. And we studied sand tables, and we checked our equipment. Now, when the first night on June the 4th, 1944, we were all ready to go, but it rained us out. The night of June the 5th, the phone rang in the hangar, and we were told we were ready to go. Now, with our equipment on, we weighed around 325 pounds, at least. Being a demolition expert, I had landmines. I had 6.5 pound blocks of TNT, primer cord, plastic explosives, and plastic caps, things like this. As we were going across the channel, it was foggy, and then it was clear, and they had given us donuts and coffee before I left, and I began to get airsick. So I got up and I hooked up and I stood in the door and I could look down and see these thousands of ships going across the channel toward Normandy. Now, because of the fog and because our planes had no radar and everything, we began to get separated. The plane began to separate. In doing so, when we went over Jersey, Guernsey Island, the Germans opened up with their anti-aircraft fire. Even some of our planes were shot down. The plane I was in, we turned in across the Sherbrooke Peninsula. And as we were going along, they gave us the command to jump. And as I went out the door, I could look down, and the Germans had flooded all of the area, the Medirect River area, with 3 or 4 foot of water. Of course, with all our weight, we hit the water. Naturally, we had no chance to get out, and a lot of them did that. Well, as I was coming down, I pulled my suspension lines, drifted over, I landed in a tree in St. Clair, just outside of St. Mary Louise, at 1:20 in the morning. Now, I went back in 2011, and a little French lady was there, and she says, the interpreter was telling her this, she said that she had been looking out the window, see the parachutes coming down, and in her house and in her garden, her yard, the Germans were bivouacked there, and if I'd have drifted about the width of a football field, I would have landed right in them and I would have never been here. But anyway, I cut myself down from the tree, and in the course of our training, they give us this. Now, we used this clicker. The one click was supposed to be answered. The two clicks, that was supposed to be a friend, okay? So I'm sitting there in the dark, the plane's going over, and nobody around. I said, well, I'm not going to sit here in the dark. Can you all hear this? Now, how would you like me sitting out there in the dark with the Germans around doing that? You get a little suspicious, so I threw my clicker away. Now in the movie Longest Day, John Wayne says, hang on to that. Could save your life and could get you killed too. But anyway, I threw it away. Sit there for about half an hour. Finally, nobody around. I started down the hill, come to a little lane road that was leading up, going up toward where the plane were going. Stone wall on each side. I started up that stone wall lane. I heard somebody coming, so I jumped over the stone wall, which is something you never should do. Slid down this bank. And believe it or not, I slid through the biggest fresh cow you ever saw. It was ridiculous. And a platoon-sized group of Germans walked by, and I want to tell you that was an awkward situation because I had worn my same uniform from June the 6th, 1944, till July the 13th. But I got cleaned off the best I could. But guys used to tease me, don't get near me, get over there. I said, good, I go up and hide where the cattle were, so Germans couldn't find me. But anyway, I'm going to tell you now two or three little stories where I have my faith in the supreme being in this world of ours. On July the 4th, 1944, I took 24 men into this field. We were supposed to attack Hill 95. And when we did, as we got into the field, we realized the field was mine. A Hitler Youth Division of young German soldiers were sitting on the hill, and they opened up with 88s and mortars and machine gun fire. And of my 24 men, there's 8 of us got out, and I was one of them. Now, in my squad alone, it took like, as we were running toward the hill, they got the Loach and the Lehrer and Tanner and Medford and Vachon. How it missed me, I don't know. But I ran to the closest hedgerow, and while I was there, I was scared, actually. But I could see a machine gun firing about 350 yards from where I was, and our M1 Garand was very accurate, up to 800 to 1,000. Well, I emptied my M1 into that machine gun nest. I didn't know whether I hit anybody or anything happened, but I never went up to see. But it quit firing and it got deathly quiet. There was no sound, no birds, no nothing. Anyway, I was one of them. I finally worked my way back to my outfit. Fought all the way down to Bellefontaine, Prieto, Chateaupont. And got down as far as the Say, and on the July the 13th, we were transported back to England. And there we trained. On September the 17th, 1944, we took off for Holland. I jumped in combat in Holland 1:30 in the afternoon, on a bright sunny day. And I was in the only plane in the 441 transport group that was shot down. And I had videos, or not videos, but I had paintings and things made of that by Jim Belcher, who was the 2nd Battalion, was on the ground. And everybody got out of the plane. Father Kenny was with us in the plane. All got out of the plane, but the crew sergeant, he jumped with a flak suit over his parachute, and he died. The flak suit was protection for him as a crew member. The plane went on down and crashed, so I survived that. Now, on the 17th, we fought that up to the old Root Hotel up in Bergendahl. And on the 21st of September, 1944, there was a Jewish family that hid for 25 months in this house attic. Never left the house. They lived, people below would furnish them potatoes and turnips. They stayed for 25 months without leaving that building, hiding from the Germans. My patrol, on the 21st of September, went down to Den Hill Woods. We liberated that family. At the time, we never knew they were there in the house. All I know is we knocked out a Panther tank and and it actually just shot through the house that these people were living in. And they, after going through the field and driving the Germans out of the village, my group that was behind me took the family of five up to safe haven up in Bergedal. On the 22nd, then the next day when we were pulled back up, we built dug some slit trenches, and all at once some 88s started coming in. I run to get into my slit trench, and my friend John Giacomelli jumped in my slit trench. I jumped in on top of him, and it exploded and killed him underneath me. I had no idea. I was wounded, but it killed him underneath me. On the way back to the field hospitals, the doctor and nurse were taking the shrapnel and stuff out of my body. And when they got through, they moved me to the tent. Messerschmitt 109 flew over the hospital, straight to the hospital. 15 minutes after I'd been there, it killed the doctor and the nurse at that very table that had been working on me. So those are the kind of things that, you know, I know that I have some reason that I should be here. Well, I finally went back, spent 2 or 3 months in the hospital. In December the 15th, I went back to Reims, France. I got my squad back. And on the 18th of December 1944, we went into the Battle of the Bulge. Now, I'm not going to go through the whole story about what it was. 23 below zero. We were not allowed to stay in any type of a building or village because the Germans would shell it, but they did. And I'm going to finish up telling you the story of why I have no idea why I was left to get home like I did. But anyway, one day we were in a firefight. I pulled my men back into the snow. It was about 3 feet deep and it was cold. And a sniper shot 2 of my squad members. And I was so upset, I told my friend Charlie Martin, we're going out, we're going to go get that sniper. I said, we're not allowed to do that. I said, well, I'm a staff sergeant, you're a private, we're going. As I was walking through the snow, all at once, I didn't go more than maybe 25 yards, and I froze in my tracks because I knew something was wrong. And very slowly, I looked around, and I seen that two German snipers, no further away than what the people were sitting in this front row, pointing his Mauser rifle at me. All they'd done was pull the trigger, could kill me. And I very slowly went, buffing the leg behind the hole, which means throw down your weapon, put up your hands, and 2 of them jumped up. Why he didn't kill me, I don't know. I have no idea why. We captured him, took him back to the command post. When I dug my foxhole that night, I got up the next morning and I'm shaking all over. My hands were shaking. I knew something was going to happen to me today. The guy came down and said, Sergeant, you wound up at battalion CP. Colonel Mendez wants to see you. I went up there and he says, I want you to take your squad, get down this lane, through this woods. There's an 88 and they have everything around it. I want your squad to knock those out so we can go through there. I want you to be the point for battalion. I said, sir, I only have 6 men. So you got to do it. So as I was walking down, I always had this firm feeling as a squad leader, that's what I did. I'm walking down this bank, along this road off this bank, and a sniper shot me through the chest. It went in my side, came out behind my shoulder blade, knocked me down, of course, and I tried to roll over close to the tree, and he shot the bark off of the tree above my head. And I passed out, and when I come to, a medic was taking my paratrooper boots off. And I have the utmost respect for medics. God bless each one of them. But I told him, I had my 45, but I said, if you might get them off, but you won't wear them. And he started crying. I'll never forget that. They took me back to the first aid station. They take me up. They loaded me onto a meat wagon, ambulance, going back to Liège to a division hospital. On the way back, there was 2 wounded German, another GI, myself, and a driver. And as we're going along, I was in the truck and the stretcher just above behind the driver. my stretcher collapsed. The arms along the stretcher collapsed. We didn't go another 4 or 5 minutes to this ambulance rolled off the side of this mountain. It went side over side over side down this mountainside. It killed everybody in that ambulance but me. I laid there until I couldn't get out, turned upside down in the river while I was going through the ambulance, but it killed everybody in there but me. If my stretcher hadn't collapsed, I'm sure it would have killed me too. I laid there until about 6:30 in the morning, some GIs walking by, some the ambulance come down and pick me up. Took me up the mountainside on into VH, and I was operating on, and from there, that was my trip home. Now you see, somewhere, somebody wanted me for a reason. So what I've done, I've spent my entire life at home. I work with my schools, I work with the community, the handicapped, I work with the senior citizens. I've done a little bit of everything in our community. And in turn, they pay back, which I don't ask for. I have a street named after me in Johnstown. I got a football field named after me in Johnstown, a baseball field, a golf lake. And none of this I asked for. But I made a promise, if I get home, I would spend the rest of my days trying to do what I could for my community. And I've done this. I love young people like you. I love to talk to you. When I listened to Dave's talking here, when I went to the Arlington in 2009, there were 351,000 soldiers buried there. On an average, almost 1,000 a week is being buried there now. And these are soldiers who fought for your freedom. I'll tell you a little story real quick. Hitler, as he had wanted to dominate the world, he wanted an Aryan race of people. He had divided our country. Japan was supposed to get anywhere from the Pacific to the Rocky Mountains. From the Rocky Mountains to the Mississippi was supposed to be Italy. And from the Mississippi to the coast was supposed to be Germany. So you can see if he'd have won, you people don't know what language you might have been talking. Freedom is not free. The soldiers that fought for you back in those days never thought about it. They just gave of their time and their will, and I'm giving it back now. And I could go on and on and on. I donated my book to your library if you ever want to read it. It's called Paratroopers Do or Die. I gave to John. And I want to thank you for allowing me to come here to blow off to you guys. And I wish you all the best. And thank you so very much. God bless you.
Getting close to your lunchtime, I want to thank your principal, Mr. Davis, his staff, teachers, and most of all, you students, for your attention. This coming Monday, think about those who gave their lives for our freedom in our country. That concludes our program. Thank you.
Again, Memorial Day is coming up. How many have a family member or a friend or relative that is serving or has served in the military? Raise your hand. A lot of us don't. Hey, again, we'd like to thank Commander Walls and Don Jakeway, the Master Sergeant Barnett, and the ROTC from the high school. And we really appreciate it from Wilson Middle School. Thank you for everything you guys have done. Thank you. At this time, we're in third period, so I'm not exactly sure what period you came out of, but sixth graders, you are dismissed first, so please head back to third.